said unto him, Lord, speakest thou this parable unto us, or even to all? And the Lord said, Who then is that faithful and wise steward whom his Lord shall make ruler over his household, to give them their portion of meat in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Of a truth I say unto you, that he will make him ruler over all that he hath. But if that servant say in his heart, My Lord delayeth his coming, and shall begin to beat the men servants and maidens, and to eat and drink, and to be drunken, then the Lord of that servant will come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour when he is not aware, and will cut him in sunder, and will point him his portion with the unbelievers. And the servant which knew his Lord's will, and prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. But he that knew not and did commit things worthy of stripes should be beaten with few stripes. For unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall be much required. And to whom men have committed much, of him they will ask the more. May the Lord grant his blessing be to his word and be sanctified in our hearts. A proper perspective of stewardship. A proper perspective of stewardship. Now, many of you young people may not be familiar with that term or that phrase, steward or stewardship, S-T-E-W-A-R-D, steward, S-H-I-P, ship. And I'm going to define that before we end this morning, and hopefully you will have a better understanding of the term steward and stewardship. But while introduction, I think this will be plain enough to everyone. Some of you here, and maybe many of you here, are able to save a little bit of money every month. And so you put your money in the bank, and if you are wise, you'll put your money in an interest-bearing account so that while you are asleep, your money is working for you. And I wish that I would have learned that a little bit better when I was younger. As a matter of fact, I knew that when I was younger. I knew and understood at a very early age the miracle of compound interest. Being one who loved mathematics, it's something that I learned very early of how compound interest can cause your money to grow. As a matter of fact, I've had an account at the bank with my name on it since I was 7 years old. When I was seven, my grandmother took me to the Mount Hope Bank and opened a Christmas Club account. And I used to sell the grit newspaper. Some of y'all know what grit is. Probably the most hyperbolic newspaper in the country. But the grit newspaper would come in, and you had to be 12, but of course, Lord have to forgive me. I falsified my age on the application. Said I was 12 when I was seven. The newspapers would come to your home in the mail once a week. They're coming on Thursday. And I would hit the pavement on Thursday, and I'd be going door to door trying to sell these grit newspapers. And paper cost 15 cents. And for every paper that I sold, I received 5 cents. And so I got a nickel off every paper that I sold. And my grandmother told me very early the importance of saving. And so I learned to save. She took me to the bank, we opened the first account, and I would put 25 cents in the bank a week. I would go to the bank, take my 5 nickels or a case quarter, and I would deposit 25 cents in the bank. And then at the end of the year, I would get a check from the Mount Hope Bank for $12.50. That was Christmas Club time. Then I graduate to 50 cents. And I put 50 cents in the bank, and I get a check for $25. And I was big time when I got to, I put $1 a week in the bank. And I was getting $52. I bought my own bicycle, bought most of my own toys. I wanted my own money. I learned the importance of saving and compound interest. And so sometimes you don't understand when you come home with your report card, and your report card is spelling Eddie's name, but your name is not Eddie. And you don't understand why your parents get exercised about that. One will explain to you why they get exercised about it. They get exercised about it because your parents are making an investment in you. And every day that you get up and there's food on the table, and there's clothes in your closet or in your dresser, and the heat is still on, television's still working, light's still working, and you consume in all of those things, your parents see that as an investment. And so your parents send you off to school so you can get an education because they want you to be educated better than what they were educated. So that you would have more opportunities in terms of employment, earning wages, to be able to have a higher standard of living. And so when you go to school and you don't understand why you're there, you see, some students think that you go to school for breakfast, lunch, and socialization. But you don't understand that your parents are sending you to school to be educated, and what they're looking for is a return on their investment. Now, most parents don't want their children to give them anything. Let me tell you this. Listen to me, students. Your parents, they don't want you to give them anything. All they want is for you to get out of their house, put in all their food, burn up all the lights, use up all the water, spend all. They just want you all for their payroll. That's all they want. And if you do that, you'll make them very happy. And they will conclude that their investment in you were worthwhile. A parent wants nothing more than their children to grow up to be self-sufficient, to be independent, to be able to take care of themselves, and so the parents can enjoy life a little bit, just a little bit. In the business world, business people want returns on their investment. So if they invest in a company, if they invest in someone with an idea, they want that idea to result in them not only getting their money back that they invested, but they want to get back some interest. They want to get back some profit, a return on investment. Now, if we as human beings, as parents, if we want our children to give us a return on our investment, them being self-sufficient, independent, taking care of themselves, if we as business people and as John Q. and Jane Q. Public trying to save for retirement, we want a return on our investment. How much more does a holy God want a return on his investment? God has a whole lot invested in us, those of us who say we're Christians, those of us who say we name the name of Christ. As a matter of fact, God liquidated heaven. Everything that heaven had, everything that heaven owned, was in the person of Jesus Christ. So God sent everything that heaven had and owned to the earth that Jesus might die in our place, take the punishment for our sins, be buried and raised from the dead, ascend back to heaven, send the Holy Spirit that we might not be comfortless. So God wants a return on our investment. There's a whole lot of debate over the tax cuts. And whether or not there should be a tax cut, whether or not the tax cuts should be permanent. But I've received a bit of interest and insight from a good friend of mine, Brother Lionel Sherry. Brother Lionel told me that, he said, look, I'm not getting into whether or not the tax cut is good or the tax cut is bad. He said, here's what I do understand. I'm in banking, and I'm in investments. He said, so when people get tax cuts who got money, that upper group they're talking about, guess what? They bring some of their money to me for me to invest. And that's a good thing. So you got some money to invest, most of Brother Lionel Sherry. Give you some good rates, some good deal. Good return on your investment. God is looking for a return on his investment. Stewardship is all about God's investment in us. Now the word steward is not a word that we use much in our culture today. Some of you who are my age or older, you're familiar with the term around construction sites, around the coal mine, they would use that term steward. In the Bible, the word that the word steward comes from in the Bible, it is derived from a word which means a house manager. A house manager. A steward was one, normally a slave, but that slave would be promoted to a position of a manager, a trustee, an overseer. And then what the master would do, because he'd observe the steward or the slave over a period of time, saw the slave had some ability, saw the slave had some skills, and recognized that the slave was trustworthy, the master would then commit to the slave the management of his or her household. Remember the Old Testament patriarch Joseph? He was sold into slavery by his brothers. He was purchased by a Roman general by the name of Potiphar, and he became Potiphar's steward. steward, and he managed Potiphar's estate, and everything in Potiphar's house was under Joseph's control. And Joseph told Potiphar's wife, "My master has kept nothing from me but you." He had access to everything but to Potiphar's wife. Potiphar had that much trust and that much confidence in him. So then when we come to the New Testament, it is with this idea that God says to us, I'm calling you not only to be Christians, and I'm calling you not only to be servants, I'm also calling you to be my friends, and also I'm calling you to be my stewards, my house managers, my overseers, my trustees. Jesus Christ came, as we said earlier, lived a perfectly sinless life, was betrayed, was crucified, buried, raised from the dead, ascended back to God the Father, sent the Holy Spirit, and in sending the Holy Spirit, he also sent gifts. And so when each one of us receives Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, and when the Holy Spirit comes to dwell inside of us, the Holy Spirit brings spiritual giftedness to our lives. But not only does the Holy Spirit bring spiritual giftedness to our lives, when we were conceived in our mother's womb, God in his mystery and divine grace, he equipped us with certain natural abilities and certain natural talents. Someone asked me the other day, they say, if you go to the doctor, do you want a Christian doctor or do you want a non-Christian doctor? I said, I want the one who knows what he's doing. I want the one who knows what he's doing. Who went to school and wasn't sleep during class, wasn't skipping class, and wasn't copying somebody's homework. I would like to have the highest confident doctor that I possibly can find, and trust by the grace of God, he also knows the Savior. That's the best of both worlds. When I go to get a mechanic, do I want a Christian mechanic, or do I want one who knows what he's doing? I want one who knows what he's doing. So what God has done, God has equipped us with certain natural abilities and certain natural talents before we come to faith in Christ. God gave us certain natural abilities and talents because God is a God of grace, and he gives good gifts. He gives perfect gifts. And God wants individuals to have a place in the society, in the world, where they can do something, and being able to do something causes them to feel good about themselves. But God then wants people to come to faith in Christ and bring all the natural abilities, natural skills, acquired education, and develop intelligence, and then surrender it to the Holy Spirit, and then God will take all of that to a whole nother level as we become his stewards. But many Christians have not really come to understand that. Many Christians view their Christianity, they view it in a dichotomized way. They say, I am a Christian. On Sunday morning, I put on my Sunday morning meeting clothes. On Sunday morning, I listen to 98.7 so I can get in the worship mode, hear some good gospel music, and try to flush some of that rap out of my head. On Sunday morning, I go to the church, and I'm a good Christian. And I teach Sunday school, or I usher, or whatever. And then after church is over, I go home, rest the rest of the afternoon, and then on Monday morning, I become a lawyer. I become a doctor, a nurse, an engineer, a banker, a school teacher, a sanitation worker, a secretary, a clerk, a technician, a maintenance operator. And we start seeing our Christianity as being something that is separate from who and what we are. What God wants us to understand is that when we receive Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, he becomes our Lord, and everything that we are then is to be modified by the fact that we are Christians. And so everything comes under the Lordship of Christ, and everything comes under the Word of God. So then we start viewing ourselves, I am a Christian who happens to be an attorney. Somebody said, that's an oxymoron. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. One of my favorite terms right here. No, but it's just a whole new life. And we're getting ready to see a holy war, see, with these lawyers. The next 4 years will be real interesting because the whole trial lawyer situation and the Republicans declaring war against the trial lawyers, and this is going to be interesting as it develops. Very interesting thing. It's going to affect some of our people here in the church. Y'all understand? I understand all this stuff. I read all these things. So I know about the pharmaceutical companies. I know about the war between the pharmaceutical companies making the drugs, and the trial lawyers who sue them when something go bad and so forth, like Mark and so forth. This is, it affects real people. And so now you start seeing yourself as a Christian. I'm a Christian who happens to be an attorney, who happens to be a doctor or nurse or engineer or whatever. And what I want to do, I want my Christian faith to influence the way I discharge my responsibility as a school teacher, as a principal, and as a student. And so as young people got to catch this idea, I'm a Christian who happens to be at Stonewall Jackson Middle School or Kaplan High School. And so if I'm a Christian in the public school system, what I'm trying to do is live out my Christian faith. I might be a cheerleader, I might be a major man, I might be in a band, I might play basketball, football, run, track. But if I do, what I want people to know, if I'm on the basketball court, I want them to understand I am a Christian, I represent Jesus Christ, and I want y'all to see what Jesus would do if he was here. He would strap on his Reeboks or his Adidas, and here's how Jesus would take people to the hoop. On the football field, I'm a Christian. I play by the rules, and I play within the rules, but if I'm playing linebacker, you come across the middle, I am going to try to knock your head off. And then when I knock you out, I'm going to say, praise the Lord. I'm a Christian. And I'm a Christian. I'm a steward of my abilities and of my skills. I'll share with some people, Christian lawyers will get together and start praying. It is the Christian lawyers who should be correcting the whole trial lawyer situation. Don't let the ungodly folk get in there and fix it. The Christian lawyers want to come together and say, we've got to fix this. We have got to address this issue. The whole society is looking at us as the scum of the earth, and we've got to salvage our profession because law is an honorable profession. And it's very important that people have respect not only for the law, but they have respect for those who practice the law. Amen. That's what it means to be a steward. I'm a steward of all of my abilities, of all of my skills, and all of my talents, and I'm trying to harness all of that and bring under the lordship of Jesus Christ so that God is glorified in everything that I do. That's what it means to be a Christian. And it means to be a steward. Now, I'm not going to be long this morning because we got communion, but I want to set the stage what we're going to talk about in coming weeks. Now, back up, if you would, please, at Luke chapter 12. Let me read some verses, beginning with verse 35, Luke 12, verse 35. Jesus said, let your loins be girded about and your lights burning, and ye yourself like unto men that wait for their Lord when he will return from the wedding, that when he cometh and knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you, that he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to meat, and will come forth and serve them. And if he shall come in the second watch, or come in the third watch, and find them so, blessed are those servants. And this know, that if the good man of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and have not suffered his house to be broken through. Be ye therefore ready also, for the Son of Man cometh at an hour when you think not. Now, these particular verses actually set up what Jesus says to them in verses 41 through 48 in response to Peter's question. Peter said, Lord, who are you talking to, and who is this parable for? Is it for us, or is it for those who are outside of the kingdom? Jesus responds in verse 42 when he says, and the Lord said, who then is that faithful and wise, what? Steward, whom his Lord shall make ruler over his household to give them their portion of meat in due season. So Jesus, in response to Peter's question, says, Peter, I want you to understand that I am leaving stewards, house managers, overseers, trustees behind to manage my kingdom in my absence. And the wise steward is the one who understands what it means to be a steward. A wise steward understands the influence. A wise steward understands the power. A wise steward understands the clout that he or she has because he or she has delegated authority from the master. We as Christians have delegated authority from Jesus Christ. And he's promised that the Holy Spirit will be with us to help us do what he is delegating us to do. So he says, the steward, house manager, overseer, one who has tremendous control and tremendous influence, and one who has the opportunity to bring to bear the standards of God's kingdom. Are you following? A steward. And we got to get the proper perspective of second thing I want you to see is, what resources does a steward manage? What resources does a steward manage? The first resource that a steward manages is his or her time. Her time. God is an equal opportunity savior. God gives everybody the same amount of hours, minutes, and seconds in a day. And so everyone is equal in terms of the amount of time that they are given on a day-by-day basis. And so as stewards, we must manage our time. Benjamin Franklin was quoted as saying, if you value life, then don't waste time, because time is the stuff that life is made of. And so we are stewards of our time. Time is the currency of the 21st century. Because there's so many things to do, so many places to go, so much TV to be watched, so many activities, people always are pressed for time. And so the steward really has to come to grips with this crisis and the management of his or her time. Management of time. It is impossible for us to serve God effectively without devoting some of our time specifically toward the ministry for the Lord. Now, all of y'all are not as fortunate as I am in terms of your life being totally designed to do ministry. And everything, every single day, is about trying to minister, trying to serve, and trying to connect in some way to be able to tell somebody about Jesus Christ. And so you're trapped in time in terms of so many hours you've committed on your job, so many hours you have to get ready to go to work, so much time that you have to set aside to be devoted to the development of your family, because that's all a part of ministry. And it's all a part of stewardship. But there also has to be a slice of time that you slice out to say, here's the time that I'm slicing out, and I'm going to devote this time to be invested in the ministry of the church. Are y'all following? Well, I'm trying to stack things here, and I'm really trying to be conscious of people's time. I don't want you at church every day. You don't need to be here every day. That's why we try to limit the amount of time we actually come. But we want to be effective and efficient when you are there, and we need for everybody to slice out some time and give some of their time to the ministry of the local church. And there has to be some time, not just coming to church. Some of y'all think just coming to church. I'm not talking just coming to church. Coming to church is important, and I want you to continue to do that. But we also need you to slice out some time where you can help us with the nursery, help us with the youth, help us with the parking lot, help us with some outreach, to where we can depend on you, because time is what is needed to get things done, and we're stewards of our time. And so as we talk about a proper perspective on stewardship, I'm really asking every member of this church to look at, how much time do I actually allocate toward the church, local church, where I'm a member, where I'm fed, where I'm nurtured, where I'm encouraged, and where I'm strengthened in the Lord. To really take a look at that. And consider what we're asking people, what I'm asking people to do, I'm going to make it plain and simple. What I'm saying, look, block out some time on Sunday, block out some time on Wednesday. Because we do a lot of ministry here on Sunday morning. And we would like to have a nursery during the Sunday school time. We need more people in the nursery right now, more people with the children's church ministry. So block out some time. Can you give me from 9:45 to 12:45 on a Sunday? Will you give, block out that much time to say, I can spend this much time and I'm going to be in church, and so while I'm there, I can do something while I'm there. On Wednesday nights, we're trying to build the Wednesday night ministry. I still believe, and I've said it before, I will say it again, I think that the future growth of our church depends upon the commitment that we make to the Wednesday night service. That's when we have an opportunity to really get people connected in relationships and praying with each other and encourage each other and feel a part of this local church. Am I making sense? Y'all looking with that blank look on your face. Now, Wednesday night is my favorite service, because Wednesday night is the time that we have the time to interact with each other. And so when you start interacting with people, you start praying with people, you hear their heart's passion, and you hear what they want you to pray for, and you start to pray for them, and they're praying for you, God and the Spirit will sort of start knitting you together with those people, and then you feel a part of their lives, they feel a part of your life, and then you see that there's much more going on here than us having a Sunday morning service. Amen. Time. Our talent. local church to do ministry and to do outreach for people. We'll talk about that more in a couple of weeks. And then our treasure, our financial giving. We're going to save that for the last. That's the one that people always think about when they think about stewardship. They think about just about giving. But stewardship is more than about giving. More about giving money. It's about giving my time. It's about giving my talent. About giving my energy to ministry. A couple more things and we'll be through. So Jesus there says in verse 42, and the Lord said, who then is the faithful and wise steward whom his Lord shall make ruler over his household to give him the portion of meat in due season? What are the qualifications of stewardship? What are the qualifications? Well, some of them are delineated there in Luke chapter 12. For there in verse 35, he says, let your loins be girded about and your lights burning. And that speaks of watchfulness. It speaks of being on alert, of being watchful, of being sharp. And as believers, we have to be mentally and intellectually and spiritually sharp. One of the problems plaguing the church today is that there's shallow thinking in the pulpit and shallow thinking in the pew. And you also solve complex problems with shallow thinking. And so Jesus says we got to be alert. We got to be watchful. We have to be discerning. And we have to be discerning the times and then seeking God the Father through the Holy Spirit to get answers to how do we respond to this situation. How do we as a church respond to this particular issue here in a way that is true to the Bible, that is true to the truth? And so he told them to be watchful. Preparedness, watchfulness, a sense of expectancy is another qualification of stewardship. Look quickly at 1 Corinthians chapter 4. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. And we'll close here in just a minute. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. And listen to what the Apostle Paul has to say about this whole idea of stewardship. Paul says, when you think about us, when you consider us, when you regard us, 1 Corinthians 4:1, in any way or any manner, then consider us as ministers of Christ, as servants of Christ, as slaves of Jesus Christ. But then he says that we are stewards of the mysteries of God. Paul says, I'm just a galley slave, the term he uses there for minister. I'm just a galley slave, and I'm down in the bowels of a ship, and I got an oar in my hand, and all my responsibility is to row, and that's all I get to do. I'm just a minister. I'm just a servant of Jesus Christ. But then he says, I'm a steward. I'm a trustee. I'm an overseer. I'm a manager of the mysteries of God, the sacred secrets of God. God commits to the church the mysteries of God, the sacred secrets that are contained in the Word of God. And so we are stewards, managers, overseers. We are trustees of the mysteries of God's sacred secrets. And then we're to take God's sacred secrets, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, we are to dispense God's sacred secrets and explain to people what God's word means. And that is no small responsibility. There is tremendous spiritual confusion today in our society about who Jesus is, about what it means to be saved, and how does one become saved, and what is sanctification, and how can one have access to God. And so the church must always see herself. We are the stewards, the custodians of the truth, the pillar and the ground of the truth, and the thing that we have the world most desperately need, because the Word of God is the antidote to sin. The Word of God is the cure for loneliness. The Word of God is the cure for hopelessness and helplessness and despair. The Word of God, it gives hope and it gives direction, for it's a lamp unto our feet, it's a light unto our pathway, it's the joy and the rejoicing of our hearts. And the Word of God not only illumines our hearts and our minds, but the Word of God goes into dark places and it explodes and gives light. And when people see light, they have a sense of hope. A sense of hope. And so Paul said, we are stewards. We are stewards of the mystery. One of the great challenges today, one of the great challenges today in 21st century Christianity is for the church to be the church. Because the world, because it has all of its special effects, the world has all of its technology, and the world is always, it can entertain people, and it can arouse people emotionally, and it can create virtual images that really aren't true. And so the church then falls into the trap of thinking that it has to compete with the world in terms of entertaining people and so forth. But there's no substitute for spiritual stimulation by the Holy Spirit, and there's no substitute for clear biblical exposition so that people can be fed spiritually, and then the Holy Spirit can take that spiritual word of God and enlighten people's minds. And I wish I was a student today. When I was in school, I mean, I just kind of just went to school. You know. If I was a student today, I think I'd be a tremendous student, because the Bible is so illumines the mind, and your mind starts to function and to see things differently. It sees things differently, and it sees things from different angles, because God, the Holy Spirit, can take a situation, and like a person who deals with diamonds, he keeps turning in the light, and every time he turns it, you see a different facet. That's the way God takes us in his word and allows me to see things from different angles and bring to bear God's truth. We're stewards of the mysteries of God. And what are the qualifications that we be found faithful, trustworthy, that we be found faithful, and that we be available? And that's one of the great beauties of the church. One of the great beauties of the church, for anybody who puts their faith in Jesus Christ, there's a place for it. Anybody who puts their faith in Jesus Christ, you qualify. Because God, the Holy Spirit, qualifies you when you get saved. He qualifies you to be a member of his family, a member of the body. He equips you to serve him in some way. Now, the responsibility lies on you to find the specific area that God wants you to serve in. The specific way that God wants to discharge what he's put inside of you. You know, I don't say this from a self-serving perspective. But almost everything that I have learned, God is never using it in some kind of way. When I was an engineering student, I can figure out, why am I working these problems, take 5 pages to work, and I really like doing this stuff. But you learn how to solve problems, how to see things, and the discipline of continuing to work at something, believing that every problem has a solution. There's an answer to every problem. You gotta keep working at it and probing it and looking at it. And so the mind becomes disciplined. And so God has taken you through many experiences. He's taken you down many roads, and those experiences were not wasted. Sometimes God takes you into things and you learn what not to do so you can tell somebody what they shouldn't do. And so some of us had a lot of those experiences. We had a lot of what not to do. And we should be sharing those experiences with others in the body of Christ. That's the qualification. And that's the expectation. That would be faithful. In closing, I just want to say one other thing. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, and we will look in depth at this passage in coming weeks. But listen to what Paul says to the Corinthians about the Macedonians and this whole area of their stewardship. In verse 3 of 2 Corinthians 8, he says, "For I testify that according to their ability and beyond their ability, they gave of their own accord, begging us with much entreaty for the favor of participation in the support of the saints." Now, the Macedonian church was the anomaly. Paul said they begged us to let us give. And Paul said they kept on giving beyond what they really have the ability to give. But what was the key to it? Well, the key was there in verse 5. And this not only as we had expected, but they first gave themselves to the Lord and to us by the will of God. They first gave themselves. Stewardship begins with the giving of yourself. That's why Paul in Romans chapter 12, he says, "I beseech you, I plead with you, I urge you, I beg you, And the mercies of God that Paul is talking about in Romans chapter 12 is everything he's talked about in Romans chapter 1 through 11. About how God has saved, how God has sanctified, how God has sealed them with the Holy Spirit, how there's nothing that can separate them from the love of God, and about how they're safe and secure in Jesus Christ. And so Paul says, I implore you, I beseech you, I urge you, based on everything that God has done for you, that you present yourself to God as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is a reasonable service. So stewardship begins first with giving yourself to the Lord. It begins first with understanding that I am what I am by the grace of God. I have been bought with the price, and the price of my redemption, the ransom price, was the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And so God has purchased me, and he's purchased all of my time and all of my talent and all of my treasure and everything that I have. It belongs to him, and he's been faithful enough and gracious enough and kind enough to allow me to manage it. But my life doesn't belong to me.
Amen.
And your life doesn't belong to you. And what will happen for all of us is that we will stand before Jesus Christ, not to be judged for our sins. Our sins have already been judged on the cross. But Jesus Christ will judge us according to our faithfulness and our stewardship. And what did we do after we became a Christian? What we did before we became a Christian was dealt with at Calvary. Jesus will know, what did you do after you became? And so I believe that this is our time. I believe this is the time for the Grace Bible Church, but I don't want it to be said that the opportunity that God gave to us passed us by. There are a lot of churches in this city that got more money than we have, and they have more educated people than we have, and they have smaller people than what we have, and they have more resources than what we have. But you find me one church that has any more favor than what we have. Favor than what we have. An opportunity than what we have. You'd be hard pressed. We can go into any prison in the state of West Virginia, members of the Grace Bible Church. Any juvenile detention center, member of the Grace Bible Church. Any school in Canoa County School, we can go in. Because we've earned their favor, and God has given us favor in their eyes. We have access to the workforce development system. We have access to many of the social programs. We know the people firsthand. And this has nothing to do with any one individual. It has everything to do with the favor of God. With the favor of God, God has given us the favor so that we would have access to the systems of the world, so as stewards, we can have influence there and touch people's lives with the gospel of Jesus Christ, and so that people could see the relevance of the Christian faith. Amen. And so what I'm doing, I'm making an appeal to you to come and join with us, because right now we're just short-handed. There are too few people here trying to do too much work. When it's time to do the work, there are not enough workers, not enough laborers. And so some are overworked here. And so our goal is to get full participation so that we all can enjoy the blessing and all feel the favor of God's presence. And so we can reach the potential that God has for us as a church, and we can reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. At the end of the day, that's what it's about. Amen. The end of the day, it's about how effective were we with reaching people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. I share this with you, and I asked you to be in prayer before I quit it. You know, I was appointed to the governor's transition team. I wouldn't even talk to those people during the election. Wouldn't even talk to them. I sent them a 76-page paper. I said, here are the issues that are affecting the community. Here's the issues that I'm concerned about. Here's what I'm trying to do. I'm not a politician, nor am I a political wannabe. So I really don't need to talk to you. Just read the paper. And if you want to do something about it, then call me, and we'll look for the opportunity to work at it. And so I'm only going to do this for a small period of time to try to have some influence and try to put some other people in positions where they can continue to have influence on the policies of this administration so that there may be some positive come out of this and show some compassion for people, and that people can see that we did what we could do. We did what we could do to influence social policy in a direction toward having compassion for people, so people can see the legitimacy of our concern for their plight. That's what it means to be a steward. You take advantage of every opportunity that you have and that God gives you and say, how can God be glorified in this? How can God be glorified? And how can people's lives be touched and influenced to where they can see that there are people legitimately concerned about what happens to them? And therefore, hopefully you earn the right to be heard and tell them about Jesus Christ. We must first give ourselves to the Lord. Give ourselves to the Lord. And when you give yourself to the Lord, God will shock you at what he will do.
Amen.
And he will open up doors for you to serve him and give you favor and give you influence and position you to where you will have the ear of someone that can do something to help somebody.
Amen.
And then you can be able to say, look, God is concerned about you. I'm concerned about you, not only now, but I'm concerned about where you're going to go when you leave this evening. Let's pray together, sir. Father, our prayer is that you would help us to gain the proper perspective of stewardship. That we would understand that you've entrusted to us and you've delegated to us tremendous authority, and that you open opportunities of influence so that your people can be present in situations and circumstances to make a difference, to bend social policy toward helping people, and then to follow that by sharing the gospel with folk, to let them know that what they need is more than just a social policy. They need a spiritual relationship with the living Christ. I pray for members of this church. I pray, Lord God, that you would just open their hearts and they will be open to all that you desire to do in and through them as individuals and what you want to do through us as a church. And we're believing you, Lord, that you're going to raise up men and women and boys and girls from this church who will understand what it means to be a steward in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, to be a manager, a trustee, an overseer, who understand what it means to be faithful, understand what it means to have the mysteries of God committed to them that they might share with others. And now, Father, there'll be one who this morning has never come to faith in Christ. I pray that they might give themselves to you for salvation, that they might realize that without you, they're spiritually lost. The only way to be saved is for them to say, Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I cannot save myself. I believe you died for me,